The Mysterious Traveler. The evening before, I had sent my automobile to Rouen by the highway. I was to travel to Rouen by rail on my way to visit some friends that live on the banks of the Seine. At Paris, a few minutes before the train started, seven gentlemen entered my compartment. Five of them were smoking. No matter that the journey was a short one, the thought of traveling with such a company was not agreeable to me, especially as the car was built on the old model, without a corridor. I picked up my overcoat, my newspapers, and my timetable, and sought refuge in a neighboring compartment. It was occupied by a lady who, at sight of me, made a gesture of annoyance that did not escape my notice, and she leaned toward a gentleman who was standing on the step and was, no doubt, her husband. The gentleman scrutinized me closely, and apparently my appearance did not displease him, for he smiled as he spoke to his wife with the air of one who reassures a frightened child. She smiled also, and gave me a friendly glance as if she now understood that I was one of those gallant men with whom a woman can remain shut up for 2 hours in a little box 6 feet square and have nothing to fear. Her husband said to her, "I have an important appointment, my dear, and cannot wait any longer. Adieu." He kissed her affectionately and went away. His wife threw him a few kisses and waved her handkerchief. The whistle sounded, and the train started. At that precise moment, and despite the protests of the guards, the door was opened and a man rushed into our compartment. My companion, who was standing and arranging her luggage, uttered a cry of terror and fell upon the seat. I am not a coward, far from it, but I confess that such intrusions at the last minute are always disconcerting. They have a suspicious, unnatural aspect. However, the appearance of the new arrival greatly modified the unfavorable impression produced by his precipitant action. He was correctly and elegantly dressed, wore a tasteful cravat, correct gloves, and his face was refined and intelligent. But where the devil had I seen that face before? Because beyond all possible doubt, I had seen it. And yet the memory of it was so vague and indistinct that I felt it would be useless to try to recall it at that time. Then, directing my attention to the lady, I was amazed at the pallor and anxiety I saw in her face. She was looking at her neighbor, they occupied seats on the same side of the compartment, with an expression of intense alarm, and I perceived that one of her trembling hands was slowly gliding toward a little travel bag that was lying on the seat about 20 inches from her. She finished by seizing it and nervously drawing it to her. Our eyes met, and I read in hers so much anxiety and fear that I could not refrain from speaking to her. "Are you ill, madame? Shall I open the window?" Her only reply was a gesture indicating that she was afraid of our companion. I smiled, as her husband had done, shrugged my shoulders, and explained to her, in pantomime, that she had nothing to fear, that I was there, and besides, the gentleman appeared to be a very harmless individual. At that moment, he turned toward us, scrutinized both of us from head to foot, then settled down in his corner and paid us no more attention. After a short silence, the lady, as if she had mustered all her energy to perform a desperate act, said to me in an almost inaudible voice, "Do you know who is on our train?"
"Who?"
I assure you.
"Who is he?"
"Arsène Lupin."
She had not taken her eyes off our companion, and it was to him rather than to me that she uttered the syllables of that disquieting name. He drew his hat over his face. Was that to conceal his agitation or simply to arrange himself for sleep? Then I said to her, "Yesterday, through contumacy, Arsène Lupin was sentenced to 20 years imprisonment at hard labor. Therefore, it is improbable that he would be so imprudent today as to show himself in public. Moreover, the newspapers have announced his appearance in Turkey since his escape from the Santé."
"But he is on this train at the present moment," the lady proclaimed, with the obvious intention of being heard by our companion. "My husband is one of the directors in the penitentiary service, and it was the station master himself who told us that a search was being made for Arsène Lupin."
"They may have been mistaken."
"No, he was seen in the waiting room. He bought a..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.